It's a pleasure to give this talk because much of the talk has been done in Shanghai in collaboration with Mintang there and other people who are visiting the Institute of Xi Jin. So it's a great pleasure to see a program which has been running for several years and which is dedicated to understand how bacteria organize themselves in collective way. So first of all, I would like to say that the world of bacteria is very complicated. It's even though bacteria are very simple organisms compared to eukaryotic cells. They communicate only by sending they communicate mostly by sending chemicals in their surrounding, in the environment, and reacting to this environment. So, in some sense, the communication is very simple. They can, okay, in terms of pattern formation, at least. But nevertheless, they can generate this kind of pattern that you see on this screen, which means that with this method of communication, they can already organize themselves in a collective way, in such a way, after evolution, of course, of thousands of billions of years, that they can produce this. And biologists, these patterns are the way for bacteria to invade their surrounding, to search for the nutrient in an optimal way. If it was a spherical wave, you would need many, many cells to go far away. If you send digits like that very long, then you can, with very few cells, you can go very far away and you can discover what is around. So this is an example of organization that you see in bacteria, and mostly the question is open to know why this is organized like that. So you have mathematical models. So what you see on the screen on the right is just a numerical simulation. So we know PDEs which satisfies that, and this model that you see here is due to Mimura. Nevertheless, we don't understand why these patterns occur. Physicists have been trying to give rules for the number of branchings or for the length of the branches and so on, but this is very, let's say, heuristic. There is no rigorous approach to that. So this is a first example, but there is what we understand better in terms of mathematics is a much simpler example of collective motion, and this is what will be leading this talk. So this is an old and very famous experiment, which goes back to the 60s. Not as far as Dirac, but already many years. And what they observed is that if you put cells in a tube, and by centrifugation you put them at on this screen on the left, it's on the left, and then suddenly you open the tube, then the cells, these bacteria, they will move with what we call traveling band, which means they move collectively all together. And you can see here on this time scale of 2000 seconds that it is really traveling with a constant speed. You can measure the speed because you have the scales on the screen. You can measure the scales, and this is remarkable. So what you see on the screen on the right is the cell density in the red spot. So you have this red spot which shows the movement of the cells, And the shape is also very remarkable because it's not symmetric. You would say, okay, Morgan, you have many cells moving randomly. This is a Gaussian. It's not true. There is an asymmetry in the cell density. So the phenomena which is behind is basically all physicists agree on this for this kind of experiments. It's a chemotaxis, which means that cells emit in the surrounding a molecule and they react by being attraction to this molecule. And so this makes that the cells want to stay together because they emit the product which attract them. So this is the reason why they stay together. And on the top of it, there is nutrient in the tube. They like to have food. So when they have consumed the food, they go to the right on this experiment to find a fresh nutrient. So the movement in some sense is due to attraction to the food, and the fact that they stay together is because of this chemotactic effect. So this hypothesis has been checked by physicists. They know that the interaction with the fluid, these cells, they move by swimming. They swim in a fluid, so you could think that there is an interaction between cells and the fluid. So this is true, but not for this kind of experiment. So, and for Bicker cells, it's easier than for Escherichia coli. So this is not an interaction between the fluid and the cells, which is a complete different subject in a bacterial movement, which is also fascinating. And the phenomena is very robust. This means that cells, you know that now they can manipulate genetically the cells, and they can always observe this kind of phenomena. So all this is well explained. Waving hands, it's easy to explain. Self-attraction plus attraction to the right, you see what you observe. So is it true that mathematically you can give this explanation? So the first idea when you do chemotaxis is to write the famous Keller-Segal system. The Keller-Segal system is just a very old, from the 70s, model. You say that the cell, so I call N of Tx the number density of cells. So we are speaking of experiments with millions and millions of cells. It's not a small community. It's a very big community of cells. So N of Tx is the cell density. They move by Brownian motion. They are swimming and moving randomly. And they have an oriented drift, which means that they like to go to the gradient, both of the chemoattractant, C, and of the nutrient, which I call S. So these are two chemical molecules which act on the cells. We will come back on that to explain how it works. The cells are attracted by these two fields. So the C attracts cells together because, as you see in the second equation, the chemical C, the concentration C, is produced by the cells and by themselves. So this is the reason of attraction. That they stay together, and the quantity S is consumed by the cell. So the nutrient is consumed by the cell, and so when they are at certain locations, they consume the cell, and they prefer to go further to find fresh food. So this model is very reasonable to explain the experiment, except that it is not true. It's absolutely not true. It's a very interesting model in terms of mathematics, and there are thousands of papers on that. I will not come back on that, especially because the solution has a finite time blow-up phenomena, which has been very much studied. But if you look at solutions, they cannot sustain the traveling bands we are speaking of. It's not possible. You can check. There are many ways to be convinced that it cannot work. When you make a simulation of that, that is what you see on the small pattern here. At the beginning, you have bends. So at the beginning, it's fine. You can find bends if you do the correct nonlinearities, but these bends are only transient. The Kähler-Segal systems wants to generate patterns which are concentrations, pointwise concentration, and this is always what you find at the end, and there are many reasons, theoretical reasons, to explain that. I would like to point out that is a big difference between this parabolic equation and the hyperbolic or the kinetic equations which we'll present later. And there are many simulations by Philbe, by Vauchelet, by others, which show that the same equations but written at the level of kinetic equations will create bends. So the patterns, the singularities are very different at the kinetic or hyperbolic level and at the parabolic level. So it's not just that when you put epsilon going to zero, the models coincides. The patterns are very different. So this is a reason why you want to go back to kinetic, by the way. So what kinetic will explain to us is why there is a much better model, which is called the flux-limited Kähler-Segal equation, which goes back to papers by Yasmin Dolak and Christian Schmeiser, or by Erban and Otmer. Maybe 20 years ago, and where they say that the flux is not a linear combination of grad C and grad S, it's a non-linear combination where you diminish the effect, you make some kind of saturation. If grad C is very big, you make a saturation by dividing by grad C. Or if grad S is very big, you make a saturation. So the flux, the drift is saturated by this nonlinear formula. So the velocity U now is bounded. And then you can simplify the previous equation and just write that C is produced by the cells, S is consumed by the cells. And now you can check this model admits traveling bands. These are solutions which look like the patterns which we have. And this can be fit to experiments. And this is what you obtain. If you fit this parabolic equation with the experiment, the experiment is a blue line, which is a little bit oscillatory, and the green pink line is the numerical solution. So you see that you can fit quite well the experiment with this model. And so the question is, where does this flux-limited Kähler-Segal come from? And the kinetic formalism will tell us how it works, where it comes from. This is the purpose of this talk. So the idea, the model, the kinetic models for bacterial movement goes back to the 80s. So in that time, biologists were able to record the motion of cells and to understand that they don't really do it for a Brownian motion, as I said at the beginning. What they do is what they call run and tumble, which means that bacteria, you see them on the left, they have this kind of flagella, which makes them swim. So they swim thanks to this flagella, which are themselves activated by a biomotor, small protein motor, very small, it's a molecule. And when this when all these flagellas are coordinated, they make a long jump. And suddenly, for some reasons, these motors are decorrelated, and then they turn. And they take a new direction. So depending on the slice, either I will call V or Xi, the velocity of the cells, In any case, the prime is the incoming velocity. So cells are turning from a velocity psi prime to a velocity psi, or from a velocity v prime to a velocity v. And so they do this kind of run and tumble, which is exactly what you see in a kinetic theory. So I have movies to explain all this. The problem is that with BBB, if I show you movies, I lose the line. So I will show you the movie later to show you what is this run and tumble on an experiment. Right now, I will continue, and if we have time, we come back to that. So what these people, I think I mentioned them, Alt, Dunbar, and Hans Hoffmeier, and Angela Stevens and Tom Hillen after, did is simply to write that cells are doing run. This is the key. So that's what I told you. The V becomes a psi randomly in the talk. So they run with a certain velocity psi, and they tumble. The tumble is just a change of velocity. It's a scattering. It's scattering, except here the scattering is modulated by the quinoa attractant and the nutrient S, the substrate. So if we forget C and S, it's simply that a cell of velocity psi prime turns to a velocity psi with a certain kernel, capital K. So capital K of psi prime and psi. So my notation is a calligraphic K is the operator. Capital K is the kernel you see in the operator. So capital K is not a symmetric operator. It has no reason to be symmetric in this point of view. By the way, it's interesting it's an interesting question to know what is the form of this capital K of these kernels. So, for example, you could say that cells, they know where they come from because they have been running, so they have been seeing the quinoa attractant C and the substrate S. So they have seen the environment. So they know what is the environment in the direction psi prime where they have been, but they have no way to decide of a better direction. When they have to decide what is the new velocity psi that I should take after a run, they have no reason to know. They cannot see what is in front of them, or they cannot feel the concentration in front of them. So in some sense, it's very unlikely that a K depends on psi. It can depend on psi prime, but not on psi. And so typically, what people have been choosing first, as a first guess, in the very early of the modeling, is say that it's a function of C minus the average of the concentration of chemoattractant or whatever is the molecule. Here I will simplify and take only one, which I call C. So you take the average, and by a mean rule, it's simpler to say that you take an epsilon X minus epsilon psi prime. It's an average along the run, and you decide to jump depending on the concentration you have. Okay, if the concentration is high, you are happy, you will not move, will not run because you like this media. So you don't want to you want to continue. If C is big, you are very happy, you want to turn because you don't want to go away. If C is small, you want to go away because it's not the region you like. So this is the first possibility to explain how the environment is interacting with the cells. So theory for existence, we did it was the very beginning of all this with Peter Markovich and Christian Schmeiser. We have a reasonable theory, but there are many open questions which are still open. First of all, our assumptions are very specific to this type of kernel K, which depends on C of X minus epsilon psi prime, which means that we don't have an abstract structure which works. And the other question is, now if you assume that cells can measure rather the gradient of C rather than C, then there are papers by Angela Stevens also on this, but they are very incomplete. So again, you have many questions about existence theory, simply existence theory for this model. So the strength of this kind of equation is known from the beginning, is that if you rescale like a diffusion scaling, as was mentioned earlier by Martin, then what you obtain is a diffusion equation. And the what you can find is that the Keller-Segal system is satisfied in the parabolic limit. And you can not only that, but you can also discover what is the coefficient of diffusion and what is the sensitivity chi, which is a parameter for the drift in terms of the concentration. And the important thing here in this formula is that the diffusion depends directly on the k, on the way on the kernel where you react to the chemoattractant C, but the sensitivity will see the derivative, the variation of C, if you want, of k. So this is, if you want an abstract point of view on that, it's simply a question of symmetry and a symmetric part, an asymmetric part of, in the operator, on the turning operator. The D will see the symmetric part, the sensitivity, the drift will see the asymmetric part. There are many papers also, I think Pierre de Gond and Frédéric Poupeau were the first to point out this kind of behavior. In any case, this is not what happens in practice. So there have been experiments showing that cells do not react to the concentration, they do something more subtle. So what they do is they measure the concentration of chemoattractant of this molecule, whatever it is, outside, which I call C, and they measure the concentration. And along their run, as long as the concentration increases, they are happy, they like it. So they will continue as long as the concentration increases. But when the concentration C decreases along the path, then they don't like it. And then very quickly, it's very stiff, they will decide of a new direction. So in fact, the run, the turning kernel is not a function of C. The turning kernel is a function of the variation of C along the path. So which means that what I call the kernel K, which enters in the calligraphic K, is a function of DTC plus psi prime grad C, because psi prime is the velocity, is the current, is the velocity during the run. So you get a very strange model compared to all those which are given by physics, let's say, where now you have this external field C, which might be emitted by the cells themselves. That's not very important. What is important is that the reaction is really along the path psi prime. And again, you see the same thing here, by the way. You see again that the cells decide of turning only from psi prime, where they come from. They have no way what is the best direction to take. So the new direction doesn't mean the new probability of direction is uniform in psi. So I will not make a long discussion about that. Believe me, this is if you scale this model correctly, the limiting model is the flux-limited Keller-Segal system. So this is something we did with Nicolas Vaucher and Zian Wang. And the small parameter epsilon that you choose to make this to rescale is the stiffness of the K. So K is very stiff. Cells, by the way, the first model, the first flux-limited model which I showed correspond to a discontinuous K, where depending on the sign of DTC plus psi prime of C, you jump from one value to another one. So this is the equation. And this is the reason why the flux-limited Kellar-Segal system is reasonable, because this is the reasonable model for cell motion. What I would like to add at this stage is this small picture that I show here, that experiments, you can record what is the direction of the cells. And here you see, for example, that if you are, so here you are in the front of the wave, then cells are mostly going to the right, because the green part, which are cells going to the right, is much more important than the number of cells going to the left. So you can record now with in the experiments on these cells exactly their velocity distribution. You can also record the time they do runs, and what they measure is that the time that they run is also longer on the right than on the left. So the green part, you can see here at the number of cells going to the right, but it's also true that you would get the same thing, the same picture, which I didn't show because of space, for the runtime. So which means that this assumption that cells are changing direction according to the variation of the nutrient is correct. So the next question we want to ask is, okay, so we are convinced that this equation is true. You will agree with me that Vlasov-Poisson, Vlasov-Maxwell, Boltzmann have a very beautiful geometric form, where you understand that a beautiful picture of geometry comes in the game. Here we have something ugly. So can we explain now this tumbling rate, where it comes from? Because for mathematician, it's not a very reasonable kernel. So this is the next step. How can you do that? And so if you want to do that, now you have to understand how the cells are moving. And in fact, the cells are moving in the following way. So here you have a small drawing explaining that. So you have the external of the cell, which is on the top, and the cell, the plasma of the cell is inside. Through the membrane, you have what I call the transmembrane proteins, which are sensitive to the molecules outside. So let's say the chemoattractant outside will act mechanically on chemically on this transmembrane protein and will send a signal inside the cell. And this signal will change the molecular content of the cell, of certain molecules, which act directly on these molecular motors. So I told you the flagella are moved by a molecular motors, and these molecules that are produced by reaction to the external field act directly on these molecules. So to model that, you see that you need now two things. There is the external concentration C, and you need an internal concentration, which I will call M, because it's a methylation level of the receptors, which will give you the internal state of the molecule, which act on the motors. And so, now what time is it? Should go fast. So basically what you do now is to write a model in terms of a Tx size of velocity, and this chemical content inside the cells, and there is a chemical reaction, which I call capital R, which makes that there want to be equilibrium in the internal state and the external state. And you look at this model now, you get an equation which is a very standard scattering equation, except that this methylation level decides of what is the kernel, the turning kernel, but it's depend on the scalar quantity small m, and that is equilibrium between the external and the internal. If you rescale it correctly with an epsilon here, what which means that you have two epsilon at two different levels. There is the one in the reaction term, which means that you have a fast reaction, a fast adaptation, and you have one in the kernel, which means that you need a stiff response to which is what I said. I mean, these responses are very stiff, and if you do that in the limit, you get that you are at equilibrium in M, so the limiting solution will go to a Dirac mass in the internal state compared to the external state, and the function F, so you have some kind of tensor product as before, but now in a different variable. But now if you look at the limiting function F of X, sorry, there's a mistake here, it's X Xi T, F will satisfy the scattering equation exactly with the kernel capital K that we have found, which is capital K, depending on the path variation of C. So this is the explanation why this model is correct if you go to the molecular content. In 1 minute, I would like to say that you can also, all this is supposing that the number of cells doesn't change, which is reasonable for these experiments in a few seconds. If you want to include cell division and cell death, you can do it. And again, you get pattern formation, and these patterns are we did that with Vincent Calvez and Shugo Yasuda, and are here. I would like to say also that there is a large literature, another branch of literature, which is on a different phenomena and different experiments, where the experiments shows that you have Levi-Walk, that the diffusion approximation is not the correct approximation for this, and you should go to Levi-Walk. This is something also we try to understand with Veranson and Mintang. It's very connected, by the way, to some models that Martin Frank looked at with Veranson, and that Thierry Goudon also considered with renewal equation. To that, it's an example where if you want the methylation level acts on the turning kernel in a degenerate way, and so you are back to the classical phenomena in kinetic theory, where if you find that the kernel is degenerate, then you can have a long Levi-Walk or fractional Laplacian de limit. So here it's also true. We are not completely happy on the scales and on the model. I think there are many, many things to understand on the scales that you put on this methylation variable to explain this phenomena. It's very indirect. That usually you do the scaling directly on the scattering kernel. Here you do it on the secondary variable M. So it's a little bit more complicated. And okay, I think there are many things to understand there. It's not finished. Okay, so I will stop here. So this was more or less a picture of what we have been doing in many years on this question of bacterial motion. Why is the flux limited Keller-Segal system answers to the question of the traveling bands on the asymmetry of the traveling bands. It's one of these examples, which are now many, there are many of them now, where you can fit quantitatively an experimental data with a mathematical model. There are not so many examples, but because physicists now are working very much in living matter, they have many, many examples where they can fit quantitatively the experiments with the models, mathematical models. And I wanted to point out that there are many mathematical questions with existence, singularities, asymptotic theory, and fractional derivatives, which are still not solved, or which are not, there is a feeling it's not complete. I mean, we are missing we are missing some things. So there are many open questions still in these different domains. I wanted to conclude by thanking all my collaborators on that. All this has been done with these people that I mentioned during the talk, or maybe I forgot to mention them. Especially all experiments have been done by the group of Pascal Ziberzan in the Curie Institute. So I stop here. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Benoît. Thank you very much. So do you have any question or comment? You can send your question also by chat, if you prefer.
For me.
I have some question. May I ask, maybe for the velocity xi are always bounded in this context, the velocity of the cells?
Yes, the velocity xi is usually taken on the sphere.
On the sphere.
During the run, the velocity is more or less fixed by the type of cells and the environment.
Okay.
So it's on the sphere and you just tumble. It's like photons, if you want, photon scattering.
Okay.
Yeah, this is a usual assumption.
Yeah, Martin, you have a question? Okay.
You know, biology is so complicated, so you can find other examples also.
Okay. Thank you.
A question and a comment. Regarding the fractional Laplacian and fractional diffusion limit, do you have any idea what the alpha is? Exponent?
Oh, yes, sure. We can compute the alpha in terms of the parameter mu and s, but not only. That's the reason why I say I'm not very happy. It's also have to do, I simplified, there is the drift, there is a coefficient power depending on m for the degeneracy, because m is a positive quantity, it's a chemical concentration. So there is boundary conditions, there are coefficients. And all this comes in, and the formula is ugly. So it's not what you want to do, compared to, we are very much influenced by your paper with Berenson, and it's far from this to be as simple. So that's the reason I say it's not, there should be something more.
But maybe there are experimental results about this also, right?
That's a good question. Yes, certainly. So the shortcoming is that these Levy walks are obtained in a swarming regime, which is a little bit different from where this model. I'm not sure this model is very true. So to fit the this is not completely clear that this is the reason of the Levy walks in this swarming. It's a little bit different.
Well, and then I have a kind of a smart-ass comment, if I may. So, Benoît, you're a much better mathematician than me, but I think you can only define the fractional Laplacian if you define it for minus Laplace. Because minus Laplace is positive, and then
it's a question of notation. It's a question of notation.
I will correct that.
It's a smart ass comment. Anyway.
Yes, that's correct. Yes, thank you.
There are other questions, maybe on chat, if you can read it. Benoît, you can read the chat?
Yes.
On the left.
There should be a term. Which qualitative thing make things that the movement is a fractional? That's the reason these are observed in experiments. I mentioned one paper, but there are at least 10 papers showing that the motion is fractional. You find them. It's very fashionable in this area to have even for eukaryotic cells. By the way, now they say that they have a long runs. And what I don't understand, there should be a term that sustains propagation in the fractional equation. I understand. Yes, there are papers on that by Christian Schmeiser and this Spanish guy. where you put the drift. Here we didn't put the drift. We did it without the drift. That's one of the weakness of the result, by the way. You should also put the drift in this. But again, the model is, even if you put the drift, the problem is still open because the assumption of Christian Schmeiser and his collaborators is that then you have long runs, that velocity can change. So you can have very big velocities for the cells, which is not what you want to do here. What you want to do here is really say that the velocity is on the sphere. So it's not the usual phenomena that you have a fat tail for the velocity. And how do you fit the model to data? Okay, so the Temblink kernel is known physically. I mean, the values of the Temblink kernel, if you make it very stiff, you have two values, k plus and k minus, depending on the sign of this variation of C. And these k plus and k minus are known because they can experimentally fit measure the Temblink kernel of a single cell. So they have ways to fix a cell at some point and look at the frequency where the biomotors will tumble. So this numbers, this is an example where the K plus, the two values, K plus and K minus, are exactly known. So these values are known. The value you don't know in this equation, the value which is you don't know is the concentration of the quantities. It's something you cannot measure. So you cannot access either to the parameters. So this one you have to fit one or two parameters to the solution. So that's the way